Now we're back. We're still in the process of waiting for the final decision on our decals. But it looks like it's a paintable day today. It has the look of a paintable day, so I'm going to get ready, do a little test, and see if I can get some clear on a tail that I've already put the ink lines on. Now, always best, I'm going to shoot some clear. Anytime I'm going to shoot clear is hopefully have a day that there's very low humidity, or paint, I call it a paintable day, but then to do a test on a test part and see if it fogs up. Wait a half an hour. If it doesn't fog up, I can paint the, I got the stab and the elevators ready to put a little bit of clear on today. Before we even mix the clear that we're going to use for actually is going to be the clear. Of course, up to this point, we've been using up at random amounts of paint. It doesn't matter. But from this point on, we're ready to start putting clear on some of the parts. So I try to define this as a 40 ship, and that would be like a Brodak Cardinal, a small Cardinal, or a 60 ship. 60 ship would include Miss Ashley, Spitfires, whatever. And I always think this is a good way to do it. Start with a quarter clear. On a big ship, a quart and a half. Just roughly. Start with this and make a mix of, this is a quarter clear, a quarter thinner. And what you have is a 50-50 mix. Now that's good. That's a relatively thick mix, what I'll call a dry mix. What that's going to allow you to do is cover up letra sets, decals, canopies, whatever, without melting anything. And I'd be putting one coat on all parts. But then from that point on, I'd want to add no more clear. Add a little bit of thinner, so maybe my second coat would be 60% thinner. And this is not a real like critical thing to do by weight or by gram weight or volume. What it is just the general philosophy of each coat you can add a little bit of thinner. Maybe the next coat 65% thinner. So what happens is you have this mix, and as you're using it up, you can add a little thinner to each coat. I wouldn't want to have more than about 70% thinner. That would be for my final coat. But each coat then in this, the first coat goes on real thick. Next coat a little thinner, a little thinner, a little thinner, to the final coat where we'll do some 1200 sanding and then put that last wet coat on that hopefully you'll have a nice gloss. Now, when you're going to do, obviously the same thing here, you could use the mix, except it's a quart and a half. But there's another way that's been real successful at doing this. Let's pretend you have a one-piece plane. Like, I don't, so I have to do this in individual parts. But if you have a one-piece airplane, you might want to do this, is take that quart and a half of clear, quart and a half of thinner, get a big jar, big can, pail, bucket, and then take this mix, which is now a 50-50 mix, and split it into three jars that they're all equal. I'm just going to make this kind of simple. So you have three equal jars. Well, what I would do is, again, putting that first coat on thick, I'd take one of these jars, put a coat on everything, nice and thick. Now when I'm done with it, I'd want to have whatever's left in this jar. I want to do all my edges, all my little extra parts with this jar too. But now at some point in time, this jar is going to be almost empty. So what I want to do now is I want to put all this mix back together into one big bucket, add a little bit of thinner. Say just add some thinner. Sounds complicated, but it isn't. If there's just a general theory to this, break it back into three jars. Now you've already got all your little extra areas done with that relatively thick mix, and I would want to put this amount on the bottom and this amount, twice the amount on the top, so that the top of my ship has twice as much clear as the bottom. And that's over the years. If you just keep adding thinner to each mix a little bit, in fact, what used to be when I used to try to do this by formula is I'd start with the clear, and every time I'd I'd remix it or have to add the next coat, I'd add a 4 ounce jar of thinner to the mix. Paint another coat, 4 ounce jar of thinner. Add another, but it's not that critical. You can just improvise and get each coat just a little bit thinner. Also, toward the end, you might want to add 10% retarder as you're building coats up. But it's good if you can keep the retarder to a minimum. Retarder tends to melt canopies, and we know it melts decals and things. But this is just a general thing. But now, because I have a take-apart plane here, I'm going to take each part individually, and I'm going to kind of keep a little mental track of where this paint is going. But I always want to wind up with a lot more clear on the top. And it's an obvious reason, not only appearance, UV protection on the top. You don't really need a lot of UV protection on the bottom, so why carry around an extra ounce of paint? Anyway, I think this is good information. I'm hoping today's going to be a painting day. I hope I'm going to be able to go out there and mix and shoot some clear right now. See, this is what I always do to my jars, and as I go through this routine, you can see I have, whoops, 3 jars. And as I keep breaking it down, the thing with the 3 jars, I'm going to get ready to start breaking it down right now. Because I want to put, this is a part that I'm keeping, this jar has the relatively thick, it's 50-50. And I want to get the first coat on these two parts 50-50. But then, later on, if I get to put a second and third coat on, this is a little bit thinner. Now, here's the good news. When I go to do the fuselage or the wing or whatever, I have a thick mix, I have a thin mix. But soon as everything has a thick coat, I'll blend these all together, break them back down into 3 equal amounts on a jar, and then put on the top. And I'll kind of do this, it isn't like an exact thing, but a little twice as much clear on the top as on the bottom. And that, what that does, it gives you a lightweight finish that looks real nice while the plane is sitting on the runway, and you don't carry around any extra weight. Now the problem is, what always happens in this time of year, they say it's low humidity and there's no chance of rain and yada yada yada. But there's always the time you need to do a test. And this is the mixture that we're going to use for the clear part. Tip weight box, it won't matter if we have a couple extra coats of clear on if this fogs up. But for sure, we want to, and this is critical, before I go and paint anything that's going to be have ink on it or whatever, I'd like this to be dry for 30 minutes and then see that I don't have any humidity issues. And it looks like this color, there's not much sun out now, but this has a real nice look. Now, these are other parts that are not going to have any problem with inking. Now, if I happen to see that these parts are fogging up, I'll have 2 choices. I can postpone this, which is always one choice, or I can add a little bit of retarder. But remember now, I only have that one little jar, so I don't want that retarder in the other jars. Then I'll keep that as oh, here comes the sun, high humidity condition. I'd like to see if you can, you can see what this color looks like. Exciting, we get some real parts painted here. I can't wait. This is one of the things right now, and I'm trying to candle it. Sure, I'm doing a great job, right? You can see that right there. Anyway, we'll give this a 30 minutes, we'll go have some lunch, and if it's fogging up, we'll make the adjustment to the paint, or believe it or not, it looks like it's gonna rain. All of a sudden, everything goes wrong. The minute you wanna paint, it's amazing. It doesn't rain for a month, and all of a sudden, you go to paint and everything's, rain today. Now, there's one other part to this. Not only does, when you're going to do this painting, does the sun go behind, the clouds come out, blah, blah, blah. Anyway, our test went okay. The wind kicks up. Just what I need. Anyway, the parts look like they're drying up real nice. Means the mix that we have is gonna be fine. This is a 50-50 mix. We can just get our first dry coat on. This will seal up the ink. Keep us from getting
getting fingerprints on everything. Even with no sun out today, this color really looks nice. It really has a nice Ferrari look to it. I guess is what I do. What a win. It couldn't be worse. Unbelievable. Unbelievable. Wind, go away. Just gotta make it difficult. Okay, well, my little parts are dry. It looks like nothing fogged up, even though it looks like it may rain. And stuff sitting up by the heating vent, that's going to sit there overnight and dry. We're making a pilgrimage down to the home of Heidi and Reuben McBride.
Look at
Karen. They have grandchildren. We don't have grandchildren.
Kevin.
Karen's gonna, oh look, he smiles. Look. See, that's what, if I had grandchildren, then I wouldn't be able to build planes. Look at his pie, this kid's got it made.
Yeah.
And you helped Grandpa paint his plane?
Yeah.
Let's take it down off the wall and paint it for him while he's not here. Let's turn it into a Strega. You got any Strega decals there? Hey Grandpa, we turned your Jap Zero into a Strega. What's he got, a PT-19?
No.
Yeah.
Oh, no.
Well, I didn't know. If I knew you guys had this much money, I would have been your friends years ago. You're going to the banquet. John and Buzz are coming to the banquet.
Yeah,
you know.
I heard, yeah.
Yeah, good.
You're going?
Oh, yeah, for sure. Now, keep in mind, Reuben just had a hip replaced, the knee replaced. Everything's replaced. Well, is there anything not replaced? You got to look at this sign he's got here. Let's see the new plane. I love your shop. By the way, I know this is where I got the original idea for the Testarossa.
That's right.
You had that picture on a wall last time I was here.
And there's one over here, too.
Nice shop, I'm telling you.
Yeah, there's one over here, too.
Oh, yeah, okay, you got a picture. All right, Testarossa, there you go. Look at this. Look at this guy, I'm telling you. You didn't miss a thing at the field this morning, let me tell you something.
Was it windy?
No, there's garbage on the field, snow.
I didn't clean that up yet.
Oh, it's a mess. It's horrible. What else you got new here? The Stregas? Which one is Stevie's?
The first one here.
Two Stregas.
Yeah.
Ooh, that looks nice.
This one's only 70 ounces. It flies great.
You flew it already.
And that's the prop you gave us.
Yeah, now what are you looking for? Another prop?
No, this one's fine.
This one works?
I'm going to get a replacement, but I'm going to get them from Randy, I guess. Just get the 12.
These come from England.
Their company's out of business, I think.
Yeah, well, they're something. I looked around. I didn't have any. If I had them, I'd give them to you.
No, they're out.
Because I can't use something that they don't make replacement parts for. That's crazy.
No.
That looks pretty good.
But I saved that spinner and that prop for this plane.
Yeah, I got this now. I sent him all those pictures on Stunt News. I didn't see if any of them were printed in there.
And me, I'm scale. I got to put a pilot in. Without a pilot, it's not a plane.
Yeah, you're a scale guy. Your life is ruined.
Here's my decals I put on.
Yeah.
Think so.
Yeah, it looks good. You got the right place to put them up on a bar. You can see like the side view and everything. Strega. So it is going to be like father and son Strega team this year,
right?
Or what? What's going on?
Yeah.
Here?
I had to open up some more heat air for the double star to cool out.
Yeah.
Cooling out well enough. It was overheating.
Yeah. How many flights you got on it so far?
Two, but they're both overheated.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so.
We'll just get off flight with the cowling off.
Maybe the engine's not broken in quite well yet.
Yeah, it could be. Could be.
This here, put it in the plane and fly doesn't work. It's got to probably need a gallon or two through it.
Well, yeah, for sure. It's going to get better as you wear it in.
Watch Papa
It came out pretty nice.
This is the Tiger that was in his old time machine, so this one's well broken.
This one's got some time on it. Okay, so that's no problem. Yeah, that's pretty good. You guys got it made. Yeah, more planes. How many planes you got in this house? I can't believe every time I come down.
It's four more up in the bedroom.
Oh. Well, don't hold back now.
Oh, you know, put it into kits.
Some people just give them away, and some people just...
Yeah, I give them away.
You know, just let them sit around.
Now listen, what's your grandson's name?
Christopher.
You need a Lionel train for Christmas. I know just the guy that's going to give you one, too.
We got another one here.
Nah, you need Gage.
Yeah, we got to get a big
one. He needs Lionel. Get that H-O out of there. You need Lionel or Mike Strainhouse.
Yeah. Told Vindy, what is your name?
Chris Mandel.
Yeah. Chris Mandel. He knows his name.
All right.
Now, you still didn't tell Wendy how Stephen crashed.
How did Stephen crash? How did he fly?
Air boom.
Well, that's very respectful.
Oh, yeah.
I see you've trained him. How does Wendy fly?
I didn't see you yet.
No, you didn't watch any DVDs? Your father's got DVDs up there already.
Oh, yeah. No, she don't crash. Wendy don't crash.
Oh, man.
Watch it. You come on, Wendy. Let's go upstairs. We cannot call it. Wendy is a good guy. Come on.
Wendy is a good guy. Keep saying that over and over again. May convince my wife of that, too, while you're at it. This looks good, too.
What?
Oh, you got all the Brodak flying buttons. You got... You dog, you got more awards than Lou Allgast here.
There was a little buttons.
I just put a nail hole through them.
That's a classic picture. They were up here. Tyser was up here. And that was just before the Twin Towers were hit.
Wow.
And there we are. Look at that. And Kent has some pictures of that, too. Was this the club picture up here? Yeah. This is a nice picture. Look at this. He's got a picture of Chicky down here. That DVD will be done soon. He's been working on a DVD, editing out all that Chicky footage. Mm-hmm. There's so much footage of that bird. Look at that bird on his shoulder. What a guy.
Seven, Harvey.
Oh, my God. So young. Look at this. Now he's an old fart.
Dole?
Yeah. Bob Dole.
Looks like...
When they had this on the front page of the paper, yeah. Banjock gets top billing. Unbelievable. It's been a good life.
Not everybody remembers Richie's Hobby House.
Yeah? Oh, don't worry. Look at when you were young. You weren't a bad-looking guy when you were young. What the hell happened to us? We're doing that. And George Gatiss with the... You know, I still have video of this. I have video when he was flying us at the club field. Oh, man. What memories. What memories. Triorama Field. Richie's Hobby Town. I even have the... O-Gage boxcar from Richie's Hobby. Oh, Jesus, brings back memories.
This one's the plane you put the Velcro in.
This guy is a legend, John Mendola. He used to let me drive his Studebaker when I was about 14. He's like, go ahead, just don't hit the fence. I love coming to your shop. It's so nice and clean. Look at Stevie when he was a kid here. Who knew you were going to grow up to be such a beast? I thought you were going to be good looking like your father. Now, Karen and I were out on a day trip today that has nothing to do with this. We're going antique, and then we happen to pass a little airport. There's a long story to this that I know about. And I told Karen I'd like to go see if the old Connie is still here. It used to be a restaurant. The chain, of course, you can see what they've done in the back. The back part is a walkway that you go in, and inside is it's a restaurant. Maybe we'll have lunch here. If you look on this side, there's a little, this is Greenwood Lake Airport in Greenwood Lake, New Jersey, right on the border of New York. And there's a long story to how he got this plane in here. Now, when I used to fly, when I had my air coupe, I used to fly in here all the time. It's a very, very short runway with a mountain on one end. So it's very easy to get, if you go out that way, it's nice and flat. If you go the other way, there's a mountain on the other end. So the way they got this in here is they made one trip, and from what I understand, got a very low fuel load, had the brakes locked up solid, and had one chance. There was no go-around the day they brought it in. It was going to be here or skid off the end of the runway, and obviously a professional guy got it in here, some guy that really knew what he was doing. But they've turned it into a very nice place to have lunch, and... Because Karen's been so receptive to my other activities today on this little day trip. I thought you'd enjoy seeing Greenwood Lake's only flying constellation. It's a Connie, triple tail, and it's a restaurant, and we're going to have lunch here. Well, funny, you can see, and as I'm walking around here, you can see they still have, the engines are still in there. It looks like they could fire it up, in fact, but I know this has been here for, I haven't flown a plane in 15 years, and I bet you this was here before it's got to be 20 years. Really interesting little piece of trivia, little piece of nostalgia. Looks like what they've done is taken the hydraulics out of the landing gear and made permanent. Yeah, so it doesn't rock up and down as people walk by. Very cool. Cool little side trip. Now this morning I thought I'd get some more painting done, and it turns out easy. The rain is just dripping and drooling and everything. Even though the temperature's really way above freezing, the humidity and the rain and the fog just gonna make this a no painting day for sure. So we need to plan around it, and as we always do, plan around the weather. Now in today's mail, we got a package from Bernie Trent. I had gotten some of these before from Bernie, and these are really handy. Now, there's only one problem, of course. We're already done with the part of the job that we normally would use these on, but they're little sandings, actually, and they're a little bit flexible, so you can get in cowling areas, and Bernie had sent some of these up. I had used them in the past. They're excellent, and he sent up, these may be helpful. They certainly are helpful. And what I think Bernie ought to do, since it's Bernie's invention, is write a little thing up or give some information, and I'll put it in my column. Let me write it up under your own name. Here's the thing, though. This is an excellent little piece. Actually, this is something they should reprint in Stunt News. This is the kind of thing, and it's from Bernie Trent. And it describes what the different sanding papers are used for. Pretty good. Anyway, we're going to use this to our advantage, but these are really... And I may in the future, this may be something for a future, I'm just thinking, maybe I'll talk to Bernie about this when we're at Brodeck, is make a full-blown article for Stunt News about, based on this type of information. But anyway, these are really handy. There's a lot of little things, even now I can picture, and what they are, if you look at them close, then they're the equivalent of Bud McKnight sanding sticks, but it looks like they're cut. Either on a saw. Now I've tried cutting them with a saw and a razor and everything. You don't get a clean cut like this. But these are available. Anyway, Bernie, anybody that would like more information about that, Bernie Trent is the man. And let me tell you one other thing about Bernie. Now we love Bernie, of course. Bernie's one of our friends. Good friend. We see him at Brodeck every year. He eats all our hamburgers. He's always got a funny story. In the note today, he wanted a radial cowl, a 4-inch radial cowl, for his plane he's going to bring out at Brodeck, a Sky Raider. Now, there's only one problem. All of the cowls I made years ago for the B-25s, the ones that I didn't use, the mold had gotten to the point where when I stored it, it didn't exactly sit level, and it's distorted now. I can't really make a nice part, but I did have one good spare part left, one carbon cowl, and I'm mailing that out to Bernie today. But let me show you one other thing that's real neat about Bernie. Now, if you look at this picture real close, you'll see I got a Baltimore Oriole hat on, and of course that's for Chickie. It used to be because we had Chickie, and now it's because we remember him so well. Well, there's the hat that we used last year, the year before. We had a Ravens hat. Now, Bernie has always contributed these hats. Every year he seems to send me a new hat, and it's always with a Chickie on it. And I always think they're, in a way, they're good luck to have. And over the years, I've worn these and had what I think is just the best life anybody could ever have. So being a superstitious guy like I am, I'm kind of carrying on the tradition of the Baltimore Oriole hat. So this is the funny thing now. Paul Winter calls me up and he goes, ah! Talking about his bomber and his new bomber and everything. And I said, Paul, if you really love me, you'd buy me a Ferrari hat, a real Ferrari hat. Well, Paul goes out on a website to buy one, and he finds that they're $125. But you can depend on Bernie. Now look, this year's hat, this will be my good luck hat for this year. Look how, boy, I'll tell you. Bernie, you've outdone yourself. Now, the only thing you could do that would be better than this would be to bring Chicky from Baltimore, bring him back to life, but I realize that might not be happening. And you have helped his memory live on, and as a token of thanks, when we finish his story, it is in the final stage of editing right now, we will get you a free copy of his story, taken from all the shop clips that we have had over the past 5.5 years. It's working out to be a pretty significant thing. But anyway, Bernie, thanks a lot. And we're going to look at what we can get done in the shop here today on a rainy day. Now, one of the things we had put off for quite a while, we were making a custom carbon tank, both for Buddy Weeder and for Ken Clapson. We finally got those in the molds, and we're going to start making up the parts in the next couple days. But while we're working on this stuff, what we're really trying to do, and the point I'm trying to make here is, you know, I'm tempted, as you can imagine, to be spraying some clear on a fuselage or some on the parts or whatever. There's only one problem with all of this. When you rush something like this and you try to squeeze out a day when it's high humidity and you try to paint, and then you have to, you almost always have to put some retarder in the material, it gets very frustrating. So rather than even think about paint, what I'm going to do is try to line up other jobs that I want to do today, among them try to get some of the tank bodies made and some of the parts made, and that's of course going to be, I hope, productive. I wanted to pull out some short clips from, and of course all subscribers, what I'll do is I'm going to send them a copy of the stunt judging clinic that we just had at the Circle Burners. I've got it on video, and I want each one of them to have it. I think Les made some excellent points and some really valid points. And because he's a Nats judge, we always are welcome. And it shows, this computer program that shows some of the little idiosyncrasies of judging, which I'm just going to put some little clips on this tape. Not a big one, not a big deal, but just something that might be interesting to you. And you'll also, if you're a subscriber, you'll get a copy of the whole tape, that's for sure. Now, Rich Jacobone called me and he said they did do some work on the field, and it may be that one day this week we're going to actually get up to the field to sweep it and clean it and maybe even get a flight or two, but for right now, it's shop work. Just one little side note here while I'm watching this. This is Les's stunt clinic, and I think this really went off even better than he thought it would, but I'm just gonna make this a separate tape because we want to include some of Rich Oliver's flights with the scores on them as a compliment to this, and it actually rounds out to be in a nice tape. It'll be the next one in this series. It's something every stunt flyer, I hope, is going to enjoy. Good presentation by Les Demet.
Now we make up a little template here.
Now while Les is making up a wheel pan template, we got something that I think is pretty cool. I got from Classic Toy Trains a video that has a lot of airbrushing and artistic painting stuff on. I'm sure there's something we can use on this, something we can steal from these guys. Or if you just like watching artists do their thing, making a model railroad, that's a whole nother issue. You got enough of that paper? There's more of it if you need it.
Oh no, there's.
So as always, Les is going to make up a template, a pattern, and we'll start looking at what the wheel pants of this are going to look like. Tomorrow, it turns out tomorrow is decal day. Rich Oliver's going to have the final decal patterns here tomorrow. And actually, we got, finally got Ken Clapson's little tank and Buddy Weeder's tank started. So this DVD that came from Classic Toy Trains has some really cool stuff on it.
I know Gerald Champ will want to have a copy of this. Okay, so you got, this is the original pattern that you made?
Yeah.
The original,
Well, all we did was glue it down to this yellow.
What thickness of wood do you want?
Construction
half
paper.
Half inch?
Well, let's take a look at a wheel and see how we're going to work this before we,
Of course, I'll go through the stuff. We probably could get, you know, we don't have to cut up a whole full piece, but for sure we want to, you know, have the lightest stuff we can get our hands on for this. It'll be a lot of carving and hollowing.
Well, okay. I don't know if you remember when we set this up, how we discussed it, but here's the original drawing, okay? Now, here's our shape. Now, what we're going to do here is we're going to take a piece of 1/16 and cut it to this shape. And then whatever's on the outside on both sides of it is going to be undercut, like, so we have that little fin underneath.
Right.
And then we're going to have to recess the back, too. You know, do our little trick with
the
fins.
Yeah.
But where's the wheel?
So with plenty of choices of wheel and hub and rubber and whatever we're going to use.
Right?
Yeah, 2 1/4. 2 1/4. Otherwise, you're never going to be able to land, you know, even at the club field. When you're on tar, you can get away with maybe even 1 3/4. I'm not sure, but for sure, where this model will live out most of its life.
540,000. I'm sorry. What am I talking about? A little over 3/4
inch. You're talking about the thickness at the hub.
3/4 inch at the hub.
Yeah. So you know you can't make 3/8 wheel pants.
No. 3/4 inch at the hub. So.
Now, are you assuming this is going to be flat? Like if you rubbed your hand over this, you wouldn't. But the wheel is showing.
The wheel is showing, but it's got to be
relatively flat. In other words.
Got to be like that.
Okay, I got you. Okay, so we're on the same page figuring this.
Yeah.
How we're going to do this.
So we got a half inch. Now let's think about this. No.
Feel like a donut?
3/4 inch.
You have rubber donuts this morning. Donuts and coffee. You got to have something sticking out so you can take the wheels on and off.
You know what we need, Winfred?
Okay, now if you take this, and use it like a wheel collar.
Yeah.
You take a 6/32 bolt, a nut, polish
yeah.
it, put the solder joint on the outside. On the real car, this doesn't turn, does it? Does that turn?
Yeah, that's how you take the wheel off.
Okay, but all ours wouldn't turn then. Well.
Doesn't have to.
But nobody will watch it while it's flying.
That's right.
Only guy I'll know is Gaffaro, and who cares what he says, right?
Yeah, John, we don't care what you say.
The specs are so high for this model. Okay, so Les is still, I like the idea.
All right, so now we got 3/4 inch.
I'll polish one of those nuts up, and when we solder it, we'll solder it so it's a polished solder joint.
This is 3 times.
Yeah,
3 inch.
That's
this
3, that's
this
3/4.
This is an inch and an eighth. So you're an eighth under.
So you really need maybe a half inch piece in the middle?
Wait a minute. Wait a minute. Because what you're trying, you got to get the bend in the wire and the wire coming up.
Oh, you bet.
So
you bet. That's got to go through the wheel pan.
Yeah.
No. It can't stick out the side. Like
got to go up through the top.
Like a drain pipe.
Yeah. Got to go up through the top. So, if we're here, that gives you from right here to here. To make the bend and go up. Then you can take this fairing here, okay?
Might be a little easier to make the little legs that go up into the wing. You know what I mean? As opposed to the side where they're, I don't know. See, the advantage, if you have them coming out the side, one of the advantages you have, you can make this that you have 2 set screws holding the wheel pants on, and you can line them up when you want to move the gear forward or back. You can have that there's a very little adjustment to cant in or out.
Right.
Just put a piece of plywood here and
If you lock this in.
Once you do it this way,
you're screwed.
It's an Aries, and then you're screwed if you want to move it. Or you got to do something else.
So that might be worth thinking about, having it a little bit adjustable, because we don't know right now. Problem with making the wheel pants ahead of time, you don't know where the plane's going to balance.
Oh, you don't put them on ahead of time.
No, but you got to make that commitment to the bend.
Well,
think of Billy Suarez's plane. He made the wheel pants before he flew the plane. And as your plane is flying, the things are always pointing down. If you put them up even, you can't take off or land. It just noses over. So he painted himself into a box for no reason.
Take a little break here and look at Kenny Clapson's Ares, Loki, named after his dog. Now, I don't know if this is the plane that the carbon fiber tank I'm making for him is going in, but it looks like a nice rendition of the Ares. Yeah, that really is pretty nice. Ken, you've outdone yourself. I just need to know if that carbon tank is going in here, or what's going on. You had a special length carbon fiber tank. The dog, obviously, and there's the real Loki right there, looking up to eat the camera.
Don't step on that I-beam wing.
That paint looks great. That should look great in the air, too. A lot like Billy Werwich's original Ares.
Yeah, but it's the side view. You want to see the side view. Yeah, that's definitely cool.
And then it'll have the little fins.
The little fins on the bottom and the reverse curves. Yeah, that'd be kind of slick.
You put the hub back. I don't even want to get that out. Oh my God, it's 2:30. Holy shit.
Oh my God, watch this man turn into a pumpkin.
Yo, yeah.
Oh boy.
You don't know.
Pumpkin, it's Halloween, baby.
So poor Les, at the end of this day, as I'm cleaning up here, he got, well, looks like he's got the prototype of this laid out pretty much, but he had to go. The weather's breaking here, it's spring-like. Dave Midgley is due in a couple of days. We got some work to do on a Testarossa in prep for his visit. He's bringing some cool stuff down with him. And I guess the biggest thing we could do today here, I gotta open a mail. I got some real cool stuff from Walt Russell in the mail.
Now, we've been kind of building along a whatever you want to call it with Walt Russell. And Walt has gotten well into having his Bearcat finished, and he's looking for another project. And little did I realize, you know, that he had this love of Helldivers. Now, what happened? He turned up some pictures of Helldivers. I'm looking around for some. I sent him out a bunch of magazines, but I don't think there was a lot of Helldiver stuff. Now, as far as I know, I don't think anybody's made a, it's a big plane, too. It's like, Les and I were looking at this before. It looks like it's like the size of an Avenger. There's probably a crew of two or maybe more. Walt's going to give me some more information, but as far as an unusual stunt ship, something really unusual, I think Walt's found something really unusual. Now, if I were building this, my initial thought would be, I would be thinking Rojet 90 without any hesitation. I wouldn't even fool around thinking about anything else, but I think what Walt's trying to do is get a side exhaust 77, according to his note. And obviously, we're going to be looking at the plans. He's drafting up plans. Now, Walt used to work for Boeing, and he's a school teacher, was a school teacher, retired. So he's got quite a bit of talent at his disposal, and I'm looking forward to looking at the drawings and maybe making some suggestions. If you look at this, I think the spats could be really cool. And I think if you made the whole top of the body a canopy like this, I'm just wondering how big you would have to make the mold. Looking at a couple of the things, I know I recognize the paint trim. If we get this decal technology as successful as we think it is, you probably could do these two items in decals. But anyway, we're going to know more about that in a day or so when Rich's package arrives and Dave's coming down. And it's just getting to be that time of year that I really look forward to. All the planes in the club are getting finished. The Stragas, we got three or four Stragas in a club to trim out. And of course, we're looking forward to Dave's plane getting it trimmed out and the Testarossa and counter-rotating props on a Tiger Cat and who knows what else. It just never ends. And what a journey it is. Now today, what was supposed to happen today was we're supposed to have this beautiful, beautiful day in the 60s. That didn't happen. But what I wanted to do is I can use it because there's no chance of rain, I don't think. But even though there's no chance of rain, I'm going to do a little test and try to get another coat, one more coat of clear. See, it's really to my advantage if I can get thin coats of clear on. Look at this wind blowing. Can you believe this? If I can get thin coats of clear on, I can build this up, and each coat outgasses nice. Man, I can't believe the wind here. Woo! Look at the stuff blowing. Yeah, they said, oh man, I don't think I'm gonna be able to paint outside today. I may have to go into the garage. The point is here, as the wind dies down, it's always to your advantage if you can get one thin coat of clear on every day for a week or some. The more you can spread out that time, the dry time, it's just better. Of course, I don't know what's happening here. We're like getting a storm here. Supposed to be nice, but then this time of year, everything is variable. But I will try to at least get one more coat of clear on everything. Just put it aside to dry and maybe not blow away. That color is really starting to look nice. If you can see, try to get the sun at the back. I want John Cafaro to see that color. Oh, that... There we go. Hey, baby. Yep, Testarossa. Even in here under fluorescence, which usually the color changes, this is really a nice color. Bob Brookins, you have done your work. Anyway, it's really blowing out there. I'm going to have to be careful while I'm painting. I don't even want to put the camera out there on a tripod. I'm afraid the camera will blow away. Now, I figured I had a little bit of time here, and I wanted to lay out a couple of ink lines on this. This piece is for all purposes done, and I could actually shoot some clear on it today if I put the ink on. But what I did, I scrubbed it down with the Johnson's Baby Powder and get out the old reliable pen. It's been pretty good so far. Now, what I couldn't decide, I still haven't decided, is what pattern of ink I want to put on here. But I found one thing using this color, and it's this color that's the issue here. What happens is it's easier for me if I shut the lights off. When it's dark, because this color tends to reflect back so much, and you really can't shoot video this way unless I put the backlight on. Yeah, I guess I could do it with the backlight. But what's happened here is when it was so bright, it was hard to connect the corners and get them nice. And I'd move the part and I'd say, oh, the reflection was bouncing back at me. So that was a problem. So what I decided to do, and this is a little bit, I guess I want to see what this looks like before I go any further. I wanted to put the equivalent of, remember, we're trying to make something that would look like how an airplane was built. Well, it's going to have ribs, more than likely. And the problem is that this line here and this line are not. This line here is down a little bit. So what's going to happen? The last rib, let's call it a rib. And I'm putting these rolls of tape under here while I do it, just as a way of backing it up. As I work these parallel lines down in here, what's going to happen is the last one isn't going to be parallel. And I don't know if I'm going to like the way that looks. But the nice thing about doing ink is you get to look at it right up to the point that you put the clear on it before you really have a problem if you want to take it off. And the thing here, I wanted to keep it, especially when Les was here, we were talking about it. Connecting those corners, much easier to do with the lights off. I'm getting a much nicer where the lines come together. Now, I'm not going to be able to put the last line in. In fact, I'm just going to look at it right now. Yeah, I guess I could put half, I could connect it. But with this kind of a pattern, it's always better to just let each line totally dry, sit here and relax, because I want to know how these lines are going to go out onto the, and I haven't figured it out yet, that's the problem. Maybe some rivet lines there might look okay. But I'm going to have to put a bar up here because, again, there would be some kind of a spar. And what would happen years ago, what I would, and I was as guilty as anybody, among other people, and we just buy these templates with squares and then I'd put one here, put one here, put one here. And it had no rhyme or reason. And in the end, I could never figure out why something looked wrong there. What's that all about? And now that I've gotten at least this far into it, at least I realize what I had done wrong. Let me put the lights on and see what this looks like with the lights on. See, this color reflects so much. You can't really do it that way. Anyway, I'm trying a couple of different ways to get this on. See, this way you can hardly even, this is what happens. You can't see the ink until you shut the lights off. So now you can see the ink better and you can see where the joint lines are. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to spend some time lay out some various ink patterns here. But again, always keep it in mind, always wearing a set of latex gloves. I haven't had hands touch this part yet because I'm trying to avoid those nasty little fish eyes and little fingerprints and things if I can. But just one line at a time, and if I like it, great. And if when I get to a point where I don't like it, take it right off. Windex takes it off, water takes it off. And the nice thing about rubbing this down, the tape is on, it's double, it's on my shirt twice. So the tape isn't really even sticky because I'm hoping I can get through this whole thing without pulling up any paint at all. So what I wanted to do is show now, I'm not happy with the way these rivets look. I don't think they look like what I had in mind. So I'm just taking a wet Q-tip. Sometimes you have to go back two or three times, but you can almost always. A little Windex, a little water, some soapy water. Now, if there's still some residue, once you take the ink off with water, the next trick, and again, I go back and forth with ink as many times as I have to. It's not permanent until you put clear on it. Sometimes it takes two or three Q-tips to get it off. The little pen lines will come out when we clear it. Tiny pen lines. Let me get another Q-tip, a clean one. Now, because I went back and forth three or four times, this took a lot longer than I thought it would, but that's the objective here, is to get it exactly how we want it. Once that dries up, I'll give it a minute or so to dry up, and then I'm going to hit it with talcum powder again. I'm going to get rid of all these. I just didn't like the way the rivet lines looked. It just didn't do anything for me. But again, well, this is the part of it that's endless. Until I'm happy with the layout, and I'm not going to start the second side till I'm done with this side. So, and if we have to carry this into tomorrow, it doesn't even matter. We have this to work on until we find a layout that we like. Now remember that old trick, we get in a corner here and you can, I gotta get my magnifiers on, clean some of these corners up. There's actually a little bit over here too. Now, I didn't know, I've done this three or four different ways and I'm not sure which way I was gonna like it. Well, of course I can go back and forth. And the trick that I was trying to accomplish here was I wanted to keep this simple. I did not want to get this to where there was too many ink lines on, and I think that kind of looks like what I had in mind. Now, I was tempted to put some ink lines down here and, you know, but the whole idea here is to keep this simple, that the shapes and the angles and things are the thing that jumps out at you, not the superficial stuff, the stars and stripes and stuff. And I'm trying to, in fact, I don't even know if this is going to work. Let me shut this light off. Because sometimes this looks totally different. Anyway, you can see mistakes a lot easier when the lights are not that bright. Because this color is so bright, I'll just show you. When you put the lights on, it just everything whitewashes out. That was quite a bit of times I went back and forth to come up with what I thought was going to look right. And the whole thing here was to keep it simple and not get it too... how could you even explain it? Not get it to where it was all full of gewgaws and stars and stripes and things. I really wanted to keep this on the simple side. And again, if looking at it from several different ways, and that little lip around the horn. So anyway, I thought this was pretty productive, well, up to this point. Now, I may be able to, I don't know how much that wind is blowing out there. If I can, I'll get a coat of clear on it tonight. And consider that this was one more. We've moved the ball a couple of yards closer to the goal line here. And I'm trying to get as much of this the little things on here, so I can see what the overall picture is going to look like when I put this all together. Now, one of the things that defines a part like this, and it's... There's a lot of ways to cheat this, but there's only one real way to get this to where I'm going to be happy with it, is to get this line around the whole perimeter all in one shot. And to do that, and I don't know if I had mentioned this earlier on in the tape, I made up the template that I wanted out of 64th plywood, put tape on both edges because each side is different, and then got this... because it's a smaller radius. I had to eyeball that radius. But without that, it kind of lost... I had done this a lot of ways. I'd done it with rivets, and I'd done it with the lines going around. And, of course, the real ribs don't go around. They end at a leading or a trailing edge. So, again, it was that same philosophy of... I'm not even sure what the philosophy is right now. But that it would look like or come apart like a real plane. And of course, you could tape this in position and just run the pen right around it. And I'll save this for hopefully at some future time I could use it again or whatever. If we build another one with this rudder shape. And I think Les's, the plane he's building at home, has this exact rudder on it. Not sure, but I'm going to see if I can get some clear on this before this day slips away. And it's getting dark out there already. Okay, the first coat of clear goes on there. Again, the whole trick here is we want to try to get as much dry time between coats. I don't know if you can see this better with the backlight on or off. It's hard to tell. We'll get all these parts up by some heating vent, even though the heat is just coming on intermittently now. That first coat of clear is on. I'll just turn the heat up to 70 and let it cook. Now this morning, I got the confirmation from Richard that the decals have left Texas. They should be here this morning. And we eagerly await seeing what the next step in this decal adventure is going to be as we try to learn what and how we can use these. Well, there's a lot of choices, as you've seen on the tape before, but we're going to be working on a wing now as soon as they come in the mail. Now, I want to be sure I'm not missing any of the... We finally got this. I'm not missing any of the possibilities of making this job a little bit better or neater or cleaner or whatever. Now what Rich sent down is, oh, look at this, we got porno nose art. All these little things are things we might use or in some combination to decorate the model. And Michelin, If we were making a racing version of this Ferrari, we'd have these all over the place, but here's little gas caps, little hinges. Yeah, Wildfire Air Racing Team. Now it looks like, and I'm going to have to carefully keep these separate, these are on clear paper. Oh, look at a Ferrari, that's nice. Ooh, that looks real nice. Anyway, and we got some here, I guess these are black and white versions of that. For whatever reason, that looks nice. Enzo, I like that. And here's the lettering in the size we thought would be the most appropriate. And the first thing I need to do with these sheets, I need to take and put a coat of clear Brodak dope on them. Oh, he gave me a couple extras here. Because we're anticipating we may need to double these up. I don't know. I don't know how they're going to bleed through. They're all on clear paper. Okay, so we got plenty of Testarossa and plenty of the USA. So the first step is going to be carefully take these out in the back and get a coat of Brodak clear on everything. And while that's drying, we could be prepping up the model. So step one, if you're trying to follow this out, these are from Rich Oliver. They were generated by John Pothier. And he arranged in the letters and numbers and things. And Rich has arranged them on sheets so he could get the maximum amount on a sheet. We, going back to our little tests, I think it's safe to say that one of the things we learned is we could coat these with Brodak dope successfully. So we're giving these a coat of Brodak dope. This is going to dry. And with the heat on like it is right now, this will take, a while to dry anyway. And while this is drying, we'll be trying to finish up the rest of the day's work because we'd like to try to lay out the whole lettering on the bottom of the wing in one day, in one shot. But obviously the first thing is to let the dope dry. Okay, we got all our sheets with a coat of clear drying up here. Now obviously while this is drying up with the heating vent on, we got the heating vent on up here. What it'll give me a chance is to put another coat of clear on all the little parts that I worked on yesterday, the little tail cone, the rudder, all those little parts. I already have clear in the gun and I have to wait for these to dry, give at least an hour, maybe a little longer because I don't want to run any risk that I'm kind of rushing this and not getting it done right. This is really going to be a critical part of the plane. And then we're going to have to lay out, I'm going to have to make some kind of pattern, lay out the wing, the lettering on a wing, and of course do the bottom first. But in the meantime, while I'm waiting here, as long as we do have a paintable day, it isn't raining, we get at least one more coat of clear on all these little parts. And then we'll get ready to lay out the lettering. Now as we're starting to build up coats of clear on this, it's really starting to look like a bright color. It really has a nice look. And by the time we get this clear on, that's be half an hour or so, I guess this will be ready to start laying out the lettering. I printed out on my printer a couple of sheets so I could lay this out in paper dolls. I can get an idea where I want the lettering to be. Now some lettering jobs, they have a reference line. In the case of the Marines, the reference line is the leading edge of the wing. So it's very easy. You just figure out how far back, how far forward you want. There's no angles involved. If you look at Miss Ashley's lettering, the bottom of it goes parallel to the hinge line. And the letters get bigger as they come to the middle of the wing, and that's parallel to the leading edge. So one of the things I thought of was putting the lettering on parallel to the leading edge, parallel to the flap hinge line. We got several choices here, and that's why it's good to have the paper dolls. So in laying this out, the first step would be to get the dimension that we want to be close. This doesn't have to be within an eighth of an inch, but I don't want to have it staggered off one way or another. I'd like to have it kind of equidistant. I also looked at bringing it down by the trailing edge. I'm not sure I like that. And and I laid it out even with the leading edge. I didn't really care for that because then it looked like it wasn't in line. So now I need to just figure out a dimension to work off the trailing edge and lay out some tape. Now it looks like somewhere around 3 inches from the hinge line, parallel to the hinge line, 5 1/4 in equally on both sides. That gives us, I don't know, something like the layout. This is always the part of the layout I look at. When you look down the wing, that they line up. I don't like to see things that don't line up if you have stripes or arrowheads or whatever. Now from looking at this in this dimension, it looks like if anything, if we're wrong, it's too far forward. It might want to go back 1/2 inch. So now it's very easy. I can just move the tape back, lay another piece of tape out, move it back just 1 hair. And once I get a final measurement on everything, I'll write all the little measurements down so I can transpose them onto the top of the wing. Then I want to cut out the rest of the paper dolls from over here and lay out the numbers. Because without this all laid out, I want to see the whole thing in full scale before I do anything like put a decal down. And when you're painting, it seems like it's a little bit different. You have a little more chance that right in the middle of things, you can take this 7, say, and just put that little hook on it. Or this 8 and make it bigger. You can make it a little fancier, but that's okay because we're trying to replicate that lettering from the car, from the Testarossa car. So the closer we can get it to that lettering, I think the better it's going to be. Now Midgley's already working on his lettering. He's making his masks up today. He's going to be coming down this weekend. So we'll be in lettering mode here. Once I finalize that, I'm just cutting it. I will lay it out by tape and with all the different layers of tape and edges and angles. This was quite a labor of love, if I remember this. I think Midgley still has this plane up in his house. We're up in a hobby shop up there. But anyway. And on some trim schemes, like the old sweeper, it's real nice to have the lettering kind of sweep back. But after doing it both ways, right now at least the decision is that it looks better parallel to the trailing edge and 1/4 inch further down. It's actually going to wind up at 2 3/4 and not 3 inches. But that's what's nice about laying it out in tape. I can move that piece of tape down. I can move this piece out. I can really manipulate it and massage it until I'm happy with it before I actually lay down the first decal. Sometimes just changing this by 1/4 inch and just adjusting the letters, and that's what the tape allows you to do. Just having an ability to fine-tune it, you'd be amazed, at least I'm amazed, when I'm very critical of this to get this look that I want. Even that 1/4 inch makes quite a bit of a change when you look at it from different angles. Now the other thing I didn't want to have it that when you look directly when the ship is flying at you, I didn't want to see the letters coming up over the front of the wing. So this is the best compromise, I think. Leave it at 2 3, it's 2 3/4 and 5 1/4. Ah, my R. Now in the olden days when Chicky was here, right about now he'd be going wild. One of these letters would wind up in his cage. He'd be stealing stuff from me. But his help was always most appreciated. Yeah, I think that gives me the look at it from that it was just a little bit too far forward the other way. Now the AMA number doesn't fill out the box because there's less letters in it than Testarossa, of course. So what I did is from inside the box, now I'll measure this in, so I'm spaced equally. The mean average center is exactly the same. and we're the same off the hinge line and roughly the same here, and possibly, well, but the more I look at it, the more I like it. I like that everything lines up this way. When I had it laid out relative to the leading edge, just didn't look right. Now, maybe that when we're done laying this out, this will be an appropriate place to put one of those Ferrari decals or something to balance this out. But even with it unbalanced like that, I think it looks fine. I think that's going to be fine. Now that I have the layout, I have the boxes that I have. Yeah, that's going to look pretty nice. Now the next step is going to be to cut out the letters. And of course I have to cut out each letter exactly, individually. I'm going to try a couple of different ways. I have a brand new pair of scissors, brand new number 11 blades, the cutting pad, and I'm just going to see which way allows me to get the most accurate cut here. Now, this is one part of the job that I knew was going to be a little more difficult than just like when you think of a decal, you think this whole thing would be all lined up and you just slap it right on. Well, I knew that wasn't going to happen. But having them individual like this really gives me a lot of flexibility to move them farther apart and change spacing and stuff. But I have to cut each one out individually now. Now here's the dilemma. Some of the angles are round, and I've been trying to find the appropriate template just to make the cutting a little more accurate. And that really didn't work out as well as I thought it would. But I have another idea. And I originally started with a metal ruler cutting all the angles. In fact, I don't know if you can see the first one I cut where the lines go past. Well, the problem with doing it that way was I just wasn't getting the edge that I wanted. And what I found would be the best is a brand new number 11 blade, brand new. Not even one cut. And probably I'll change the blade every three or four letters because I want to keep it crisp right on the end. So then, having gone through that, I found the best way was I had a clear ruler with a good edge. Now, the advantage of a clear ruler, let me just show, is you can, this is one of the, absolutely one of the tips that I think is going to work for everybody. You can line up very carefully right over that little edge line. In this case, it's a 7 that we're cutting, and I want to leave that what amounts to be like an edge line right on the letter, razor this off. Now what I'm usually in the habit of doing when I backmask and things is just go all the parallel lines this way, and I'll keep track of how many of these, and I'm cutting on a Rodak cutting pad. I don't think if you did this on glass or something, it would be anywhere near as good. You've almost got to use a cutting pad. I was going to try scissors, and by the time I cut out the paper template lettering with the scissors, I realized, and this is a brand new pair of scissors. If Karen knew I had her brand new scissors, she'd be having a fit. But that's why she loves me. She knows models come first. I'll buy her a new pair of scissors when I get these old. When these are ruined, then she can't figure out why they got dull so fast. Anyway, the idea here is that I still have to cut that curved edge. Now, I wasn't real happy because this is not really a circle. It's almost, you almost have to make a template for each one, almost like for that rudder outline. But I think the only way I'm going to cut on some of these, where there's a predictable curve, I'm going to find the template to cut this out. Again, we're on clear paper here, so this is going to give me a lot of choice as well. Before I go too, here it is right there. Okay, but that's not the case with the 7. The 7 is almost something that you have to, in fact, I'm going to have to. There's no point fooling around here. I'll be here all day. So I want to get some of these letters laid out today. So what traditionally on a decal job, oh, I didn't cut that, is not a big deal. This turns out to be one of the things because we're going to ultimately have to backmask these. Now, what's going to happen here, I'm going to do all the cutting, because what's going to happen is once I get the swim of things to do the cutting, I'm going to want to cut them all out. So I'll make two piles, one for the top, one for the bottom. And I can do the rest of this pretty much off camera. But what's going to happen with these letters is, when they're backmasked and I paint the red, then I may have to go back in and get an ink line around all these edges. I don't know yet. I hope I don't. But even if I do, it's not a problem, because we're not looking at this as some expedient way. For a letter this simple, I probably realistically could have just backmasked the whole letters in the same amount or maybe slightly more time. But then I wouldn't know about decals. See, I wouldn't add to the database. So by doing it this way, I hope that I'm getting two things. I'm spending maybe a little less time than a full backmask job and laying out the black and all this stuff. But what I'm getting from it is the knowledge, and that hopefully little things like trimming these out with brand new blades. This might be a key part of this. I'm not sure. But the cutting pad certainly is, the clear ruler is, and most of all, brand new blades. So I'm going to cut the rest of this, line it up, so I have both sets cut and ready to go. So once I start laying the decals down, I can just go, just like laying bricks.
We'll come right up here. Just about.
You're looking to get the spoke right in the middle?
No. Spoke ain't never going to get in the middle. But your spoke will come right up, well, behind it, probably somewhere back here.
Okay.
All right. But it'll come up pretty much right on that seam, centered on the seam.
Okay. So, Les is working on day two of the wheel pant evolution. I'm working on seeing how many of these I can cut out in a given day. And Al Raby almost has the Sea Fury designed. He's still working on the Al. These are old videos. We need new videos. New. Need to see the plane finished.
Actually, Al sent me these up a while back. We've been playing them, but interesting. When you're doing a job like this, and this is just endless razor blade work, it's nice to be able to watch somebody else build a plane or design it or carve a wheel pant or whatever. So it gives you, makes the day go by a little faster. You ready for coffee?
Yeah, that's
a great idea. Why did I know that was coming? The curve, as you're getting the curve blended in there. Yeah, it's starting to really take shape. Nice. Hard to believe you got two full days in this.
Not two full days. I was here 2 hours yesterday,
well,
and that meant laying it out.
Yeah.
And today I'm here an hour and 45 minutes.
You got a few hours in there. No doubt about it.
Yeah, but you know, you go to school on the first one.
Yeah. Second one will go very quick.
Yeah, right.
As hard as this might be to believe, you just couldn't make this up if you wanted to. When Rich ran off the letters, there's no ones. The ones aren't in the actual decals. Now, there's not one letter in the decals that you can make a one out of. So that makes that an easy thing. And you would think, well, that's not a problem because you can just reprint it. Well, Dave has the ability to reprint up by him. So we go to our computer with wonderful dial-up service. And every time we get to about 3/4 of the way through sending him the file, AOL says, oh, please try again. You couldn't, Les, you must have better luck than me with computers, because you don't seem as militant about it. But have no fear, in the next week or so, we will be getting DSL lined. The Testarossa needs a DSL line. We got one cut out. We're in the middle of cutting another one out. Unbelievable. Let's see if that ever goes. We're on our, 10th try to send this file to Midgley, and it isn't there yet. All right, so Les got to this point on day two, and he still hasn't decided on the back how he's going to taper it or how much he's going to taper it, but he's going to go home and think about it, and I'm going to cut some more letters out and wait to get the ones. Hard to believe. You just couldn't make this stuff up. Ever since we started with these decals, it's just been like the ultimate adventure. Now, I tried to lay down the first letter here with the solution that they recommend, and there's only one problem that I see, and it may be a deal breaker. is the edges on this are just peeling up like crazy. There's no way that's going to work for me. All of the edges where we've trimmed it with a razor and a scissor, they're just curling up and I can't get them to lay down no matter what I do here. And I really don't know at this point if there's going to be an answer to this. I don't want to do the reason I don't want to do the whole wing. In fact, I'll try one more letter here, even though I don't have the one yet. Dave is making up the ones. Kind of, well, I don't see how that can be. See, the problem is, let me show you, show this up close. See, on a close-up, I don't know if you can see that. That edge just constantly curling up like that is, there's no way that's laying down flat. Now, it could be that if you had the whole thing in one piece, you could lay the whole thing down, and that might be an answer. But you'd, what you'd need to do here, and again, I'm at the point where I'm ready to throw the towel in on this because I just can't. I don't want to have it compromised this much. This is not, these edges are not what I want to have here. So I've thought about this basically all night, and I'm going to think about it overnight, but that I don't think is one of the alternatives we'll be able to live with. And I could run by hand on there and feel it. That's terrible. And I don't know how to correct it. Now what I'm going to do, just for my own education, I'm going to try doing a couple more numbers and letters and whatever, but I don't want these to dry on here. Because I think what I'm going to have to do is reorient and figure out and just backmask the letters, paint them, whatever. And this is pretty disappointing, but those edges, and see, like on an ARF or something, that wouldn't be a problem. But when you cut these decals with a razor, and this was a brand new razor, that's really what the edges look like. So I don't know. I don't think there's going to be an answer. And I basically spent the whole day cutting these out. I don't know. You know, when I get to a point like this, it's always best to think about it overnight. Have a cup of coffee, come back in the morning. That's pretty disappointing. I was hoping that was going to lay down a lot better. Unless I can figure something else out here. I'll make a few phone calls tonight, but right now that doesn't look real promising. That's not what I had in mind. Now, no matter what I did, and there's probably a solution for this that I haven't figured out, but those edges just kept curling up, and it was just terrible the way they were coming out. I laid out two or three more letters, and each one got worse. It's just wasn't going to happen. So what I decided to do is, before I go to bed tonight, what I'm going to do is paint where the letters are going to be, and I came up with another plan of action. It really wasn't my first choice, but you know, this whole project, I wish it was the first choice. I'm going to lay out the letters in tape. I'm sure in the future I'll figure some way of making these decals work better, but right now the individual letters, I was just not happy the way they laid out and the edges curling up. The other thing too that I think I've learned from this, and I think it's important, is if you're gonna do a decal like, for instance, where it has 72618, what you really have to do is make it all one decal. When they're individual letters, they're just very hard to control. And it's too many edges. See, you probably could bury the edges. Well, I'm not sure you could. But I know this is, the paint method is the devil I know. So rather than just call it quits, I got enough time tonight that I can paint where the letters are going to be. I'll take off all the tape, use some M600, clean up the wing, and get that area painted white. And then tomorrow I can start laying out and back masking the letters. So it was a very valiant effort, but some of the things that I know are not going to work in the future. I know cutting the letters out with the hole in the middle, that isn't going to work. I know one thing, going over red with these decals, even with all the testing, it just isn't a good way to do it. Now, if we had the plane, some other way that we could deal with this. But right now, that just doesn't look like that's going to happen. And I talked, well, I had a couple other ideas of what I could have done, how I could have done it, or backmask these exact letters. But the problem is when you go to backmask with masking tape, getting this black right in the middle is going to be difficult. So rather than do an exact copy of the Testarossa lettering, which is what I wanted to do, I'm going to try to make it close, but it's going to be all square edges. And maybe that in the end it won't look so bad when I start laying it out. But boy, what a disappointment this has turned out to be. But again, I'll learn from it. And tomorrow, once I paint this, I'm going to clean this off, paint this area white. The reason for painting it white, and again, this goes back to what we originally said, and maybe I'll make the letters similar to Miss Ashley with it bigger in the middle or something, just to try to make it fancy. The problem, as with everything is once you've painted something and you've got a picture in your mind here, you know, it's hard to just go backwards now. It's hard to say, oh, throw in the towel, boy, and I don't like doing it. But on the other hand, I know when I'm going down a dead-end street here, unless I can make these, the trick is going to be to, and I don't want to spend, Richard's away at VSC, Midgley's already made 10 sheets of decals. I don't want to go back and back and back. I would have to still make the whole decal. I would have to back mask it and paint it because this stuff bleeds through, the red bleeds through. See, if the plane was white, this would be a whole different ball game. I think you could live with those edges and just ink around them. But with those edges, and then the fact you'd have to back mask the edge to paint red, it's just a lot easier to do it this way. Anyway, defeat is tough, especially this hour of the night. Now, we still don't know if we're going to be able or how we're going to be able to use some of these other decals, but I know one thing. I've got to make a decision here on this lettering, and right now it doesn't look like the decals are going to be the best way to do this. And I guess if there is any good news, the good news is it's still not too late to get the white painted on this, and tomorrow I can start the backmasking. So we've actually... See, now, here's the other thing, too. If a week ago I knew I was going to backmask and not be committed into the decals or try, I'd be a week ahead right now. Well, that's too bad, but at least we really tried. I really put some effort into making this work. But the downfall of it all is that it has to be red. The trick is decals on a white plane, no problem. And I'm not sure about yellow, but boy, if you're going to have a red plane, think it through before you order up a lot of decals or whatever. I'm not sure. Maybe I'll feel better tomorrow. Okay, what I want to see is if my white dried up. Now, what I had thought about doing, I got out the Testarossa book. What I wanted to do in this session is I wanted to look at, and I'll do the bottom first again. I wanted to look at the possibility of laying this out. It might be a great idea. I just had a great idea. I think I'll turn the lights on in the place. There we go. Well, when you don't have your coffee, it's tough. But what I wanted to do here is I wanted to try to do this. I was thinking about this for quite a while now. The same way, with the same look as Miss Ashley. And the more I thought about it, the more I liked the idea of the letters being outlined in white and how that stood out real good on the red. So, and I thought another good thing here is I'm going to measure up this dimension, since this is the parallel dimension. And ironically enough, Testarossa and Miss Ashley have the same amount of letters, believe it or not. I'm going to lay this out, lay the basically the outline of that where the lettering will go in some eighth inch tape. Now I have some of the blue fine line tape, and then I want to look at, and I'm not going to get this all done in one session, but I want to look at some of the possibilities of maybe creating, actually I spoke to John Cafaro about some of the things he was thinking about the lettering, and he was kind of disappointed as I was that the decals hadn't worked out, but he's confident that we'll be able to come up with something that'll satisfy the vision of our whole project here. So without spending any more time, it's time to get out the Testarossa book, drink the coffee, get the tape out. It's time. Now, I'm trying to lay the box out with this, the blue masking tape, which doesn't have a real good stick, even though this doesn't seem like a great roll. Even though it's supposed to be, I get rid of that first piece. And if I can just get this blocked out before I make any commitment, I'll be real happy. Now, I want to put a piece on here. This is just going to be a piece that's going to get removed ultimately. Now that lets me work up. Let me see if I can dial into this. So I'm not sure we can get this all on the screen at once, but now I want to measure up. In fact, I ought to use my... Oh, I'll tell you, until that coffee kicks in, you're a dead man. Okay, now I got lines that I got lines and they're pretty much the same rough dimension that I used on Miss Ashley. I just want to double check that I'm starting with a parallel line, parallel to the trailing edge. Now I need to take into account when I'm making this taper, and what I'll do, I'll measure up the Miss Ashley letters and get this line relatively parallel to the leading edge. So this lettering job will get bigger as it gets toward the middle of the fuselage. Again, I'm just working off the rough dimensions that seem to evolve off of Miss Ashley. And all I'm going to concern myself with for now is to lay out the word Testarossa. And this, you could follow this step by step. Another good lettering thing is the one for Strega that I did. The original Miss Ashley, the gold leaf lettering. I've got enough of these do-it-yourself lettering things. And the thing with this is each one can be unique. It can be moved side to side up, and there's no edges. These decals. Okay, now the first step, once I get the box, this is where the lettering is ultimately going to live. I need to look around, and I can see that I'm a little bit, how should I say it, a little bit bigger than I really intended to be. Not a real problem, but I thought, and I went from the letters, but you know what? The Miss Ashley has some capitals. So I want to stay inside this box if I possibly can, and I can, if anything now, I can make it smaller. I don't want to make it bigger. Now I need to lay it out in terms of... and try to get something similar to that, but I know the reality is it's not going to be exactly like that. I divide it up. So what I have is a box for each letter. Now each letter is going to be a kind of a custom thing. So I don't know at this point. I'll start with equal boxes. But let's say, for instance, if I decide one letter has to be bigger, wider, longer, then if I move this piece of tape down, let's say a quarter of an inch, I just move each one from that point down. I have a little bit of extra. It's favoring the outside by a little bit because I don't know what the final spacing is going to be yet, and I don't know if I'm going to want to put some little changes in the letters until I actually come up with the design that I'm going to be happy with. And doing this part, this is very time consuming. I'll allow a whole day for laying something like this out until I'm happy with it. Now I also have to consider the aspect ratio. I already have the letters are relatively high relative to how wide they are. Now on a Testarossa lettering it's wider, but then I'd run out of room. It would be just get too long for this size letter. So I'm going to have to kind of compromise here on that part of it. Okay, this is the striping. It's really striping tape I'm using to lay out the outline of the letters, which in the final product is going to be white. So we're going to leave this on for both back maskings of the letters and of painting the wing red. But this gives me a little idea how I'm going to like the letters. Do I want to make them wider? Do I want to make them thinner? Actually, what I could do is make one letter in the thicker size, one in a thinner size, and then decide which I like the best. And I can always change them, of course. But to get the concept of what I have in my mind. It looks like I have the aspect ratio right for what I had in mind here. And I'm not going to be able to do this. There's just no way to be making that, do a replication of that in tape. Is just out of the question. Now what I wanted to see which of the lettering thicknesses I wanted. And this is 5/8, this is 3/4, so when I looked at it from every angle, I liked the 3/4 better. So all I'm going to do is pull this letter out. There's really nothing I can salvage here, because I have to move all the parts around. And this is what's nice about doing this kind of, well, this kind of a little layout. You have a lot of flexibility until you actually spray paint it, I guess is the right word. And I have a habit of just putting this tape right on my shirt. I don't know why. Now I'm just curious, once I lay the whole word out, then I'm going to want to make changes. So the earlier in the layout that I can decide I want to make changes, of course, the easier it is. Now there's a lot of little tricks to doing this. And I'm not sure I'm not sure I'm going to be happy one way or the other here until I actually lay it out. But it turns out when you're doing 3/4-inch lettering, you can just use a piece of masking tape over and over again. So this works out real easy. It makes the layout just a little bit easier anyway. Now in this case, you always have to think about this. A lot of times you can't lay the E out because you have to put this piece of tape down at the bottom. There's always decisions to make along the way, depending on what the lettering is. Now, in a crossbar like this, we're going to have to cut out the middle, so that becomes a problem. So as soon as I get this laid out, then what I want to do is I want to find out where that middle is going to be. And if the middle piece here, as these fan out, the middle piece goes right through the center. It bisects it, so most of this you can do by eye, but if I really was in doubt, I'd just go and measure it with a... Now, I originally started out thinking I was going to try to make one of these fancy T's like the Testarossa lettering has. And when I thought about it, I said, you know, what I want to do is lay it out in block letters before I add any fancy, anything unusual to it. And with this tape, what I do is I just don't press it down. Just enough to hold it in place until I decide what I want. Now, whenever there's two pieces of tape coming together, I try to cut it to the corner that I'm going to lose. Just makes a little bit neater of a job. Always need to leave a little bit of the tail hanging out. Now, in this case, this is one of the little tricks, and there's 100 of these little tricks. I even forget what they are in between doing these jobs. Now I want to pull this piece of tape out of here. So the easiest way I can get that out right now, I can get this one cut to the corner. That takes care of him. Now I got to make sure I'm using a really sharp blade because I don't want to cut into the substrate. If I'm lucky and the blade is sharp, I can pull that right up. Now the thing that I've just come to grips with here is this is not going to be a 1 or 2 day job to do this. We're now looking at, I say days, it's a lot of sessions, because even if I have the time, there's other things going on around here. Some of them good, some of them not so good. But anyway, if I lay one letter out here in real time, I think everybody could pretty much figure out the rest of it. And being able to adjust it, being able to make it thicker. Now, one of the choices we would have had is we could have laid this all out on a computer and then had a mass cut. That would have been another choice. But again, that would have added time into our waiting to get the mass cut, finding somebody locally or having to get it done and shipped over here. And we're just, right now, we just want to get this going. I do anyway. As I'm working on it every day, I want to get it going. Rich Jacobone's itching to work on his Stuka. I don't know if they're going to want to work on that Saturday or not. Everybody's getting to this point in the year where what they really want to do is get the planes ready for Brodex. Now, even after I lay this out, if I want to change it, I want to add some details to it. Now, there's two ways to do these corners. When my fingernails aren't as chewed up as they are now, I can use my fingernails or the dull edge of the razor just to press those corners down. And I'll press them down before I seal this with clear. When we get to that point, we're not going to be able to do that in this session. I think if we just lay this, if we get even part of this letter laid out in this session, and I still need to finish up Kenny Clapson's fuel tank. Okay, so we basically have, now we're looking at 3/4 inch letters. That center bar moving up. Now I have to take into account when we do the S that bar is going to go up too. But I guess to start with, and it's just redundant from this point on, I'm going to do each letter the same. To get the whole thing blocked out in block letters and stand back and take a look at it and see what the next step on this is going to be or where we're going to add some fancy stuff. As I work on this, I'm just trying to evaluate, see, like the S's look a little bit like the Miss Ashley S's. So I'm seeing what I can use. See, I haven't done this yet. I haven't figured out if I want to do that yet or how I want to treat some of these letters, because I want to lay them out in block form first. But it's given me a lot of food for thought, because this is a process that just goes slow and you have plenty of time to think each letter through. Now, I made so many changes to this that still not happy with the T. I don't know if I'm going to put that. I'm going to think about it tomorrow. Try to make it more like the Testarossa T. I had the A with a curve in it, but then it didn't match anything. And I like this, that everything's straight edges and it's kind of razory and sharp. And, well, so far so good. Now I'm picturing how that's going to look. Yeah, I think it's going to look fine. When we lay out the other, had to take into account that this lettering is going to go right through the gear block, so I'll have to back mask this and paint. Obviously get down in there and everything. But that's a whole nother day. Now this actually consumed a whole session. It's about 6 hours of work doing this. But I've got the baseline now of what I want to have. Now I have to think about it. Think about maybe putting some, maybe not. Maybe keeping it simple is the answer. I don't know. Maybe trying to make it too fancy might not work the way I want it to. Anyway, I'll think about it. I'll get Les's feedback. Les may be able to make it tomorrow early to work on his wheel pants, so we're just going to think about it. And a lot of times, after you sleep on something, it looks a lot different when you come back in the morning. The Les is being introduced to the world of carbide cutters.
Tungsten carbide.
Tungsten carbide.
This ain't the cheap stuff.
Looks like it's working pretty good, though. You know, the thing is, you can get it to cut without burning.
Exactly what's happening. And the other thing,
it's cutting nice.
Whatever, the other nice thing is you have a lot of control.
Yeah, well, that looks pretty good to me. Did you buy a set or did you just buy one?
No, I bought individual bits.
They work well, though.
Yep.
Boy, that does cut nice. Well, while Les is working on that, I'm going to rejuvenate myself and get busy taping off the other side, and hopefully take another look at this and make a final decision on the lettering today.
Hollowing out.
Hold it steady so I can see what it looks like up close. That's got some good edge. If you got a toothache, that's the one I want. Man alive.
All right, let's just see what happens here.
Yeah, watch, you don't cut your nose off with that one.
No, I'm going to treat this one.
I still think they work great. Put the drill press up to a million RPM. Is that cut nice? Oh, my God. Look at this guy. We're going to rename him Mr. Tools. Man has every cutting bit on the planet here. Yeah, that looks like it's working pretty good. Now, Les just came up. What a great idea. We're watching his show called Pinks, where they drag race and on Speed Channel, and the loser loses his car to the winner. And Les wants to turn that into, at Brodax or at the Nats or something, we're going to have Pinks, where if you don't win, or you can't get enough of your friends to judge, you give your car. Les is going to enter his vet next year in that event.
You're right.
I don't think this Testarossa is going to. These beer drinkers are all drag racing cars here. This is so funny. And they lose them and they lose their car. But anyway, it's good background noise while we're laying out the letters. And I had to this one. Luckily, it the gear block wound up right in the middle of the S. So that'll work it nice and easy to get that where you won't see the gear blocks. It won't define right out. Yeah, as this lettering is laying out, what I'm liking about it is that it's simple. It isn't gigoy. I was tempted to start changing things and letting this slip up and other things, but for right now, just getting this all blocked in, and then we'll kind of look at it, look at Miss Ashley, and make some kind of an educated decision, and then we'll get out the airbrush. Les is dying to airbrush this for me.
I took a little bit off each side. I got to take more off this side.
Right.
You'd be surprised how well this big block
works. It cuts
because
nice.
It's got some got some heft to it.
Snowing balsa wood here. Now, unfortunately, Les entered his vet in some Pinks race, and he opted to drive him home tonight. I don't think so.
No.
Not
those guys,
me.
Those guys have to be... Well, I don't know. Maybe some guys get their jollies doing that.
They're just idiots is the problem.
You know, we're still going to have this problem of the way it looks underneath. Maybe a little...
Let me see that from the top view. Let me see from the top view. No, that's going to look even more. I would taper it even more.
Well, okay.
You're the artist here.
But retaining that vent thing.
Yeah.
I don't know that we have to.
I'm not unhappy.
Like a regular wheel pin.
I'm not unhappy with this lettering. The more I look at it, that
we're going to do the top differently, though.
That looks good.
We're going to do the top differently. Probably be better if we tapered it right to a point.
Well, maybe you're going to have to bite the bullet and do that. And
I like these flares, though. That's
you know what it is. Really, you've got enough character in there with the curves. You might be trying to. Just make it too fancy, you know?
Yeah, that's true.
You might already be at the point where you can quit while you're ahead here.
Yep.
Three letters to go. Now, we were hoping that this was going to be a 60-degree, no-wind-blowing day. Les says, Laugh all the way, baby. It ain't happening.
Oh, man.
Yours.
So I spoke to Les about this lettering. He has some ideas. I asked him if he wanted to put that little T that sticks up, and he didn't think that was going to work or add anything to it. So we've at least eliminated that possibility. And now that we've looked at it for a lot of hours, laying out these last two letters, and we're going to hope get some airbrushing done today, but or at least get one side masked out or whatever. But this has really been a labor of love. I'm not sure. Anyway, it looks like the result's going to be fine, and it's going to be something that's close to what we want once it's back masked and airbrushed. But again, we have learned, and the critical lesson to learn is never make decals that are in individual letters. They have to be in sheets. You have to take the color options that you can't go over red, or you can't go over this or that or the other thing, into account. And I would say this, the lesson to learn here more than anything else with decals is have a test model, run through the whole gamut of things that you want to do before you actually make the commitment to do it on the model. Do the color tests, do all of that ahead of time, and maybe not learn from the lesson that we've learned that there's a lot more to it than just putting a decal in the water and spraying clear over it. Thinking it through, and of course other people have already, Richard Oliver's already thought it through, so I would say it's really possible to do it if you have a white plane, light color plane, and the decals are in big sheets where the letters are pre-lined up and there's no holes in between them. Again, I'm just trying to make up some of the do's and don'ts from this learning experience. And you can always keep in mind, if all else fails, you can buy yourself some striping tape, and this is the fallback system. This is, of course, not test one, but at least we're not limited now to where we can't have lettering at all. We're just limited in, now we got to airbrush it. The next thing that we got this laid out is carefully get all this extra tape out and get the back masking that we need done for this side. Then we have to seal all these edges with clear with a tiny brush, as we've done in the past.
Biggest one you got on the roof.
Quarter.
And that wide? His letters and everything came off the drawing board. This is not...
Now this is always the trickiest part with the letters, especially with this tape. Now one of the things I learned with using this type of tape, the non-masking tape, is absolutely you got to seal the edge with clear, and in the corners is where it usually bleeds through. So when I'm done, I usually try to get just a little extra right in the corner if I can. And it's the tip that I can think of is never stretch the tape. When you stretch the tape and lay it down, it distorts a little bit. Now that I have all the back masking on this side off, now the next thing is going to be to flip it over and do the other side. I wanted to give this a little time to dry. I'll get this side, let it dry, and then flip. Now that I have the layout, the idea is to try to just use all the dimensions and just repeat it on the top of the wing. Once this is all dried up, I'm going to let this dry. And any little spot that looks like the tape isn't sitting exactly the way I'm happy, press it down with the edge of your finger. I'm trying to wear gloves to keep the schmutz on this to a minimum. I'm going to leave the little blocks in place, and then I'm going to have to repaint the white stripe going through them. But it looks like, well, as soon as I finish the clear on this, we'll be all set. Now you might think, one of the ways I originally thought I would, of course, this is changing by hour, I originally thought the way the time was working out, that I would do one side, get the letters airbrushed in, and then flip it and do the other side. And I thought because of the way the timing worked out, I have a whole nother session right now, and I'd rather lay out, and the advantage of doing this, of course, is that I can spray and back mask all at one time, and I'll have the exact, when I do the little pearl in the middle, I will not have to remix it over and over again. So it might be, ultimately, it'll be a time saver to have both sides masked out at the same time. The first side, if I remember right, took me about 6 hours. This side took a lot less, so I might be able to get both sides masked out in one session. But what I'm going to do is transpose all the numbers right off the bottom and basically repeat the whole process of doing the top, because now I know, and Les agreed, we have the balance that we want, and I like the taper. It's very similar to Miss Ashley, of course. And so now it's really just a question of taking all the measurements. Before I go any further with this, what I want to do is, and it's a good idea, we have a little bit of degreaser left, not much. Boy, everything you need in this hobby you can't buy anymore. Anyway, to clean this up real good and start the back masking, that is really not much point in just redoing it over and over again, unless we come up with some magic bullet, some magic formula. And what I had done when I sprayed this, I wet sanded it with 1200, just a little bit, just so the tape would lay down better. And of course, anytime I can, I try to use the surgical gloves, but you can see even at that, you're still picking stuff up off of the painted surfaces. So I was trying to keep track of the time here because we already have the layout. So having the layout means we're a little less on each panel, and I've really, each panel you can almost deduct a third or a quarter from the time it takes to lay it out. It's amazing, but it's that first panel and getting the first layout to where you're happy with it, and then from that point on, and always by doing the bottom first. If I wanted to make some small adjustments, and when I looked at it, I'm not sure I'm going to make any adjustment at all when I actually come down to do the lettering. And the more I look at, what's nice about this is the more I look at it, the more I like it, as opposed to the other way around, where it starts to look like it's going to have a negative impact on the plane. Now, as happens every time I do one of these, is I realize that here's the point I'm trying to make, is when you lay out the first set of letters, you think, oh, that took 6-8 hours or whatever, but the second one will take 4, the next one will take 3, and I've gotten to the point where this is moving right along, and I'm hoping that by the end of this session I can even get the clear on this and get this all done in one session. Boy, that would be a real time saver. But again, because of all our experiments, we're looking to make up some time here. We lost quite a few days. Not a big deal, but I'll feel a lot better when all these letters are cleared and this is ready for its airbrushing little episode. I'm dying to see what this lettering's gonna look like too. Well, it's been 5 rolls of tape. Countless amounts of, I don't even know. And the only thing left to do here is pull off all the border tapes, seal these letters with clear, and I don't think we're going to get anything else done in this session. But it did go as predicted. This side went a little faster than this side, which went a little faster than this side. But boy, when this is all, when I'm ready for that clear and that clear is drying, of course the clear has to dry overnight, and tomorrow we'll be ready to back mask. And, well, I really hope if all goes right, we get a day we could paint outside, because we'll be ready to airbrush the letters once that's back masked. Ah, this morning it looks like we got a bright sunny day going on here. Maybe a good day for painting these numbers, so let's get down to the shop and get back masking. Got a lot of back masking to do before we can spray these numbers. Now, because we know we have a good day, here's what I didn't want to do. I didn't want to get this all back masked out and then find out I don't have a good day to paint or have to paint in the house. I'm really hoping I don't have to, but unless that the wind kicks up out there or whatever. Now we know we have a painting day. I want a back mask. The trick with doing this lettering is, and I've got it all sealed with clear, it's dried overnight. I want to get the masking tape for the back mask going to go right up about to the middle of the tape, but not... When I pull a tape up, I want to make sure I don't pull up, because I'm going to do this all with an airbrush. I don't want to pull up the blue tape. I want to paint the letters. Then what I want to do is carefully take the back mask off and back mask the letters. Then from that point on, I can take everything off. So it's this first time of back mask, and I have to be ultra, ultra careful in terms of getting, not getting any extra tape. And I'll kind of do this just as a... Let's see how long we need this. What I want to do is I just want to have hopefully about 1/8 of an inch of tape stick out, and I want to use the blue if possible, because it has very little. This is the least sticky of all the tapes. Even though it's the least sticky, I'll rub it on my shirt anyway. Now if I can get this, then of course I have to tape in between the letters. But the trick with all back mask, and I don't want to leave the tape on any longer than I have to. I want it on there. I want the least amount of stickiness. Now I'm going to try to line up right to the middle of the tape, so it'll be a little easier to get it off. Now see, there's only 1/8 of an inch of tape actually touching. I don't want to even over press it down, because when I'm airbrushing, I'm going to have this in a vertical, no matter how I do this, even if I have to do it in the back room, I'm going to hang it, and I don't want to shoot down, because then it shoots under the tape. I want to have the surface here and be shooting at a 90 degree to it, whether I hold it or whether I hang it. I want to be right up against it so the paint doesn't tend to bleed in these corners. So let me get the rest of this all back masked off. I'm looking at it, I'm thinking, yeah, I'll be able to, we'll be able to airbrush some of this today if that weather holds. The idea is to get that tape right in the middle. It's been de-stickyized by rubbing it on my flannel shirt, which just came out of the wash, so it doesn't have any lint or anything on it. And I'm right in the middle. Now, just cutting little pieces of tape to go inside, I want to do the same thing. I want to take pieces of, hopefully get this all masked off, but at every point in time, try to get it that only the minimum amount of tape is touching. Now, whenever there's a really big wide area, you know, I try to put a little piece of tin foil in the biggest part, but in areas like this, where it's really the thickness of the tape, again, I don't need to press this down because the airbrush is not going to put that much pressure on this. And we are really trying to be very careful about working around the weather, but right now we look like we're having one of those days that paint will dry very well. And if we're shooting for the middle of the tape, when we go to pull it up, it'll be even easier because we can see it. As soon as we're pulling up the striping tape, I have to really stop, go back and reseal it. I want to make really keep that to a minimum if I can help it. Now, unfortunately, by the time we get this all back masked, it's going to be the end of this tape. We want to pick up the airbrushing on the next tape. So I hope you've gotten some ideas from this tape and, well, see about the possibility of using decals and the limitations I've found already, and maybe in the future we're going to find some ways of making that even better, but I think we've learned a lot in the last couple of weeks. Now, one thing for sure, the lettering on a model really is one of the defining features, and whether it's a Red Baron or a Cardinal or an Impact or whatever, lettering can make or break the plane, and I hope, you know, with the modern technologies we have, computers now and paint masks, there's still a lot to be said for the old school way of just back masking it. It goes quickly, and I didn't intend to do it this way, but like a lot of things in life, this is how it wound up. Even on things like back masking that mouth on a Spitfire, a snaggletooth kind of mouth, or back masking Invasion stripes, back masking the George Aldrich tribute here. Back masking is one of the key things if you want to have a really nice